Hi everyone. This is a follow-up video to last week, and I want to help put some perspective on the Jian Ghomeshi trial, help people cope with the role they played in Canada's biggest media hoax, and to point your attention back to the guy, Jesse Brown, who started this travesty. For those of you just catching up, Jian Ghomeshi was a popular radio host in Canada who had his private sex life exposed by the Toronto Star just over a year ago, alleging that he beat women up as part of his kink. This led to the destruction of Ghomeshi's career, his private life, and his freedom after criminal charges were laid. The trial, which started on February 1st of this year, has resulted in proof that Ghomeshi's accusers lied and that the allegations are part of a vicious campaign to destroy him. So let's look at how this happened. The man behind this fiasco is Jesse Brown. Jesse Brown, at the time a freelance journalist who hated Ghomeshi and the CBC, built this story up for 4 months before it was published in the Toronto Star. He was a contact point for all of the accusers and has been actively overseeing the fallout, pushing his narrative onto the public. The real story that the Toronto Star had on Jian Ghomeshi back in October of 2014, when all this began, was best suited to sites like Gawker or BuzzFeed. The story that Jesse Brown had been working on was meant to expose to the world that Jian was a kinky guy who practiced BDSM, and that his lifestyle didn't mesh with the image he presented in public. And to have the biggest impact, Brown wanted it published in a more respected paper like the Toronto Star. He also wanted insurance against the lawsuit that would surely follow. Brown spent 4 months developing this story and increasing the stakes from just kinky sex to criminal assault. He worked so closely with the women, who were his sources, he said he felt like a therapist sometimes. One of the sources was a friend of his, and he was a witness in his own story. Brown failed to disclose his personal involvement at the time of publication. It's unclear whether or not Kevin Donovan, the Star's investigator that he worked with, was aware of this fact. Let's be clear on what kind of journalist Jesse Brown is. Brown started his writing career pulling pranks on mainstream media, from Wikipedia. He also engaged in elaborate pranks on local mainstream media organizations, such as putting out a press release from a fictitious dot-com company, Baby Talk, about a fictitious product, Baby Talk, that empowers Canadian infants to communicate with Japanese, Australian, and German tots, and helps them make friends all over the world and learn valuable job skills sure to aid them in the new economy job market. CFCF, CTV's affiliate in Montreal, shot a piece on the fake product by the non-existent company featuring a woman with her 2-year-old baby, both arranged for by Brown, that aired on the station's 6 p.m. daily newscast. Well done, Jesse Brown. What else has he been up to? Between 2003 and 2004, Brown wrote a humor column in the Saturday Night Magazine in Toronto. Simultaneously, he continued setting up pranks that served as fodder for the column. In 2003, using a pseudonym, Stuart Neihart, Brown staged a media hoax that several Canadian publications fell for and reported on as news by publicizing the launch of Stew, a regular guy magazine for the adequate man, envisioned as an antidote to then-popular lad magazines such as FHM and Maxim. So this is Brown's style. Pulling hoaxes on the media is basically just a good day for him. I'm going to suggest to you that the Canadian public and the mainstream media have fallen prey to the best troll in Canadian history, and he's a malicious troll. Jesse Brown struggled to get a full-time gig with CBC, but they passed on his idea for a show called Canada Land, which Brown has now been able to crowdfund with the attention he got from the Ghomeshi story. He has accused CBC of stealing his ideas. He mostly makes a living accusing mainstream of fraud, sexism, and targeting various celebrities with claims of unethical behavior. This is what Brown does for a living. People watching the trial of Jian Ghomeshi are wondering how the claimants have fallen apart so spectacularly, one after the other. Not only have their stories crumbled, they have been shown to be outright liars. People are outraged, and they want answers. Brown, who has a vested interest in the public continuing to believe his fabricated story, has scrambled to explain. On February 7, 2016, Brown published an article telling the public that Ghomeshi kept extensive files on all the women for blackmail purposes. This is Brown's characterization of Ghomeshi's penchant for keeping messages. In reality, keeping these messages was the smartest thing Ghomeshi did in his romantic affairs. Most importantly, in this article, Brown claims that he knew Ghomeshi had proof of consent. Somehow, that didn't make it into his article in October 2014. It also didn't seem to be something he thought the police needed to know about in their investigation. To be clear, I think Jesse Brown's article on February 7th is almost as big of a hoax as the original one, except for one thing. I believe the email that he's offered, as an example, comes from his original story source, and that this is also the person who created the infamous @BigEarsTeddy account on Twitter. For those of you who don't know, Big Ears Teddy is supposed to be a teddy bear Ghomeshi had in his bedroom. This account was created on Twitter at the time Brown claims to have started researching the story, and he was one of the first people Big Ears Teddy followed on Twitter. So let's look at the claim Brown makes in his recent article. Here is some of what Jian Ghomeshi wrote in 2013 to a young woman almost 20 years his junior, after she confronted him to say she believed a recent encounter between them was not consensual sex, but an instance of manipulation which resulted, she told me, in brutal non-consensual violence. The email goes, "Dear blank, say dear Big Ears Teddy, it is about sex. It was. I have text messages from you saying you want this. The rough sex was something you were very interested in. You wanted it to continue the next day, and in subsequent messages and notes, reread our texts and re-examine our conversations if you wish. I wish for good karma into 2013. Yours, Jian." Now, you would have to be really thick to believe that with all the time Brown spent talking to and purportedly acting as therapist to these women, that he didn't know about this email before. What he and the women didn't know was that Ghomeshi would still have emails from over 10 years ago, too. Now, a lot of people want to characterize that as creepy, that Ghomeshi would keep emails that long. But think about it for a moment. Jian Ghomeshi was a famous person, a man surrounded by women, having sex with quite a few of them, and ending their affairs after a short time period. He was also known to have anxiety problems. It makes a lot of sense that he would try to protect himself from jilted ex-lovers. Ghomeshi even has proof that Big Ears Teddy lied. According to his original Facebook post, she wrote to him afterwards, reneging on her accusations. I think we all know that he still has that email. Surely Jesse Brown was aware that his original source admitted she lied. That also didn't make it into his story. Let's revisit Jian's original and infamous Facebook post. Now that we know he can prove what he is saying, we should take his statements a lot more seriously. So this is Jian Ghomeshi's version of events, and I think it's important to understand that not only is he saying this, but he can probably back up every word. "I have always been interested in a variety of activities in the bedroom, but I only participate in sexual practices that are mutually agreed upon, consensual, and exciting for both partners. About 2 years ago, I started seeing a woman in her late 20s. That would be Big Ears Teddy. Our relationship was affectionate, casual, and passionate. We saw each other on and off over the period of a year and began engaging in adventurous forms of sex that included roleplay, dominance, and submission. We discussed our interests at length before engaging in rough sex, forms of BDSM. We talked about using safe words and regularly checked in with each other about our comfort levels. She encouraged our roleplay and often was the initiator." And you can be fairly sure he has emails to show that. "We joked about our relations being like a mild form of 50 Shades of Grey," and he goes on a bit about that characterization without wanting to get into details. A wise choice. "Despite a strong connection between us, it became clear to me that our on-and-off dating was unlikely to grow into a larger relationship, And I ended things in the beginning of this year. That was the beginning of 2014, and the research for this story started only a few months later. She was upset by this and sent me messages indicating her disappointment that I would not commit to more, and her anger that I was seeing others. That is potentially what the dot dot dots in the email were that Jesse Brown removed from the email he posted. After this, in the early spring, there began a campaign of harassment, vengeance, and demonization against me that would lead to months of anxiety. It came to light that a woman had begun anonymously reaching out to people that I had dated, most likely the same woman, Big Ears Teddy, via Facebook to tell them that she had been a victim of abusive relations with me. In other words, someone was reframing what had been an ongoing consensual relationship as something nefarious. I learned through one of my friends, probably Sarah Bobas, who got in contact with this person, and probably still has the messages, that someone had rifled through my phone on one occasion and taken down the names of any woman I had seemed to have been dating in recent years. This person had begun methodically contacting them to try and build a story against me. Increasingly, female friends and ex-girlfriends of mine told me about these attempts to smear me. And I'm fairly sure he has proof of that. Someone also began colluding with a freelance writer, that would be Jesse Brown, who was known not to be a fan of mine, and together they set out to try and find corroborators to build a case to defame me. She found some sympathetic ears by painting herself as a victim and turned this into a campaign. The writer boldly started contacting my friends, acquaintances, and even work colleagues, all of whom came to me to tell me this was happening, and all of whom recognized it as a trumped-up way to attack me and undermine my reputation. Everyone contacted would ask the same question. If I had engaged in non-consensual behavior, why was the place to address this the media? I think that's a really good question, and I think that's one that should be investigated. The writer tried to peddle the story, and at one point, a major Canadian media publication, that would be the Toronto Star, did due diligence but never printed a story. Of course, Toronto Star printed the story the same day this Facebook post went up. One assumes they recognized these attempts to recast my sexual behavior were fabrications. Still, the specter of mud being flung onto the internet where online outrage can demonize someone before facts can refute false allegations has been what I've had to live with. And of course, that fear came true. And this leads us to today and this moment. I have lived with the threat that this stuff would be thrown out there to defame me, and I would sue. But it would do the reputational damage to me it was intended to do. The ex has even tried to contact me to say that she now wishes to refute any of these categorically untrue allegations. And again, I'm sure he still has that email. But with me bringing it to light in the coming days, you will prospectively hear about how I engaged in all kinds of unsavory, aggressive acts in the bedroom, and the implication may be made that this happens non-consensually, and that will be a lie. But it will be salacious gossip in a world driven by a hunger for scandal, and there will be those who choose to believe it and to hate me, or to laugh at me, and there will be an attempt to pile on, and there will be the claim that there are now a few women involved, those who colluded with my ex, in an attempt to show a pattern of behavior. And it will be based in lies, but damage will be done. But I am telling you this story in the hopes that the truth will finally conquer all. That was a fairly good prediction of the future. The most important thing here, in terms of the Toronto Star running their story about Jian, is that they published it the day Ghomeshi posted this statement, claiming that it gave them justification to talk about the allegations. What people overlooked was that Ghomeshi informed them in this post that he had proof their source lied to them. The Star didn't seem overly worried about their main source having admitted to lying. You'll note that, except for Big Ears Teddy, who later admitted she lied about the nature of their activities, knew Ghomeshi could prove it, and thus never went to the police, all of the accusers in court have something in common. They never got laid. They were dating him, and he cut them off before they got any dick. They also have in common that the encounters were 10 years ago, and they were really sure he didn't have their emails and letters anymore. These women would have you believe that Ghomeshi's style of sex was to suddenly punch them in the head and then act like nothing happened, and tell them to show themselves to the door. They wanted you to believe that Ghomeshi was sexually satisfied by punching women in the head. That's all he was after. That's it. No actual sex. Just hair pulling, choking, and slapping them around. You, the Canadian public, actually believed that to be true. You thought that's how Jian Ghomeshi had sex with women. It's outrageous. Ghomeshi was careful enough to keep all his correspondences. Do you still think he was stupid enough to punch a woman in the head with no warning? Let's find out just how gullible the Canadian public is now. You've been used. Jesse Brown pulled off the biggest media hoax in Canadian history, and in your love for scandal, you let him get away with it. That's a sad fact that can be somewhat remedied. Revisit Jian Ghomeshi's Facebook post and read it with our new knowledge. Jian was telling the truth. Jian Ghomeshi is guilty of leading a double life, being into a sexual lifestyle that didn't match his public persona, but he was not guilty of a crime. The only crime committed in this case was, in my opinion, a vindictive slander campaign that turned criminal when Jesse Brown let the hoax continue into a police investigation and the Canadian courts. The next question is whether or not the star's Kevin Donovan knew that it was a lie, too.